For the uninitiated, indoor gardening can seem a bit strange. I mean, think about it. Plants have evolved over 450 million years to exploit solar radiation, a very special energy emitted by the sun. Ah, then one day, a young man named Everest had a pipe dream about growing plants in his basement, a place that, thanks to being encased in brick, stone, and cement, receives pretty much no solar radiation whatsoever. Who'd have thought that was a good idea, huh? Well, grow lamp manufacturers. Yes, grow lights. By virtue of their name, can grow plants without the sun. But how well do they actually perform? Suffice to say, the more accurately our grow lights are able to replicate the characteristics of the sunlight hitting the surface of our planet, the better chance my basement-dwelling plants will have of growing, blooming, and delivering all the good stuff. So today, folks, we're going to discuss the characteristics of sunlight, how this energy affects plants, and look at some technologies and strategies available to indoor growers who want to try and replicate it indoors. Everybody knows that plants absorb sunlight. Well, yes, kind of, but not how tissue paper absorbs a spillage. That's just a physical absorption. One substance, being mopped up by another. Nice. The crucial difference here is that sunlight is energy, and it's this energy which powers important chemical reactions inside the plant. Think about it. Plants uptake water via their roots and absorb carbon dioxide through their leaves, but it's the light which provides the energy needed to break these molecules apart and join them together again as something else, in this case, carbohydrates. Without light, this reaction couldn't happen. So what's going on here? Well, plants contain special light-harvesting molecules called pigments, and one family of these pigments is called chlorophyll. It's what makes plants green. Now, a photon of light hits the chlorophyll. An electron in the chlorophyll becomes excited. Ooh. In this higher energy state, the excited electron can be passed along to another adjacent molecule. Think of it like a chain, the electron moving from one chlorophyll molecule to another, until finally it gets passed to a molecule of carbon dioxide, and bam! Together with good old H2O, this energy helps bust these apart to create carbohydrate and oxygen. One photon is only capable of exciting one electron. However, complex pigment molecules such as chlorophyll contain many different electrons which only get excited by photons traveling at certain wavelengths. Now, sunlight is a full-spectrum continuous light source. It appears white, but it actually contains all of the visible colors all of the time. Because sunlight contains photons of all of these different wavelengths, the chlorophyll gets excited. Really, really excited. Okay, I've already discussed PAR, or photosynthetically active radiation, in an earlier video. This refers to the band of radiation between 400 and 700 nanometers which plants use for photosynthesis. PAR is a measure of light intensity for plants, but it tells us nothing about the spectral quality of the light source. A high PAR value could be generated from very narrow bands of greens, yellow, or red light that would be far from ideal from growing plants. So with full spectrum sunlight as our gold standard, what's the closest we can get to it indoors with grow lights? Light emitting plasma, my friends, or LEP, or LEP if you're super lazy, is the nearest to full spectrum light. The problem is it's still expensive, so I guess we should keep our fingers crossed that it becomes more affordable soon. HPS and double-ended HPS tend to be heavy on yellow, orange, and red. Not much going on in the blue. However, iHortilux offers a super HPS which has 25% more light energy in the violet, blue, and green bands. This makes it an awesome flowering light which doesn't just bombard the plant with orange-yellow photons, helping to increase overall crop quality. Commercial indoor growers following a compound multiple lighting plan often supplement the spectrum of their HPS lamps with light-emitting ceramic, light-emitting plasma, or enhanced metal halides such as Hortilux Blue. If, like me, you grow on a smaller scale, you could opt for a dual arc tube lamp. It's basically a 1000 watt rated lamp that combines a 400 watt metal halide and a 600 watt HPS in one. A more recent development is nanometer specific T5 lamps. There are physical limitations on the spectral output you can achieve from a single triphosphor lamp, so the idea here is that you mix and match different lamps in the same fixture. Say if you have an 8 lamp fixture, for vegetative growth you could choose 4 power veg full spectrum plus UV lamps and add 2 420 nanometer lamps and add 2 460. Or divide these numbers in 2 for a 4 lamp fixture. For flowering, switch out the 420 and 460s for 633 and 660 nanometer lamps. Plants grown in full spectrum or at least broader spectrum tend to be more structurally sound, more disease resistant, and have better tastes and aromas. Remember folks, it's not just all about PAR and photon count, it's about spectral quality too. Okay, that'll do it for now. Let me know your questions and comments below. As always, this is Everest in a full spectrum of white light, out.